everybody, and welcome to Spooky Takes. Purposeless Rabbit Holes is a short-form impression show with a name so good, it never stays the same. Today we're here to talk about Amnesia Rebirth, the long-awaited sequel to what I think can easily be called one of the most influential horror games of all time at this point. Sure, The Dark Descent isn't Resident Evil or Silent Hill 2, but I guarantee we wouldn't have Outlast, Alien Isolation, or PT if the original Amnesia didn't explode onto the gaming scene the way it did all the way back in 2010. The Dark Descent popularized the bitch-made-punk genre of horror, and we're still getting countless entries into that subcategory today. In fact, it's pretty much the only horror we're getting. Everybody and their mother was streaming this game a decade ago. Shit, this is one of the first games I ever recorded on a channel that you will never find because it is hella embarrassing. If I could chuck it off a cliff, I would, but setting it to private will have to do. So, is Amnesia Rebirth a worthy successor to the certified success that was The Dark Descent? Can it hold a candle to the original? Has the oil run dry, or are the boxes still tender? Well, to get my opinion out of the way early before we take a trip into spoiler territory, I think Rebirth is a better game than The Dark Descent, but I didn't enjoy it as much. Rebirth has a lot of good stuff going for it. Replacing the tinder boxes with matches was a smart call, as your source of lighting up the environment now also doubles as a limited time mobile light source to keep you sane on the go. The puzzles are relatively engaging, although a bit too numerous throughout, and I really liked talking to my Bebe! You play as a pregnant protagonist throughout Amnesia Rebirth, a bold call that I actually really respect. I haven't seen that shit before, and narratively it works quite well throughout the story. You grow closer to this baby at a similar rate that Tassie does, because you find out about it at the same time that she does, which is initially very shocking and uncomfortable knowing that you're in for about another 10 hours of spooky ass bullshit. You can hold B to look down at your stomach and talk to the baby, which functions as a clever narrative device allowing you to manually listen in on Tassie's train of thought whenever you feel like it, and it also serves to calm her down in moments of high stress if you hold B for baby when the little one kicks, which happens seemingly at random. It's an RNG get out of crazy free card, basically. Speaking of crazy, all the YouTube reviews I've seen of this game seem to be really down on its method of letting you know that you're getting to dangerous levels of instability by—
Ah, fuck me!
Nah, but really, these mini jump scares never really bothered me because I rarely encountered them. I managed my sanity appropriately, always looking for spare matches to give myself a brief respite from the horrors lurking in the shadows, and I was fine. I saw these flash game maze faces like 3 times throughout the game, and even though they can be jarring, I think the sound is balanced well enough for them to come across more as indicators of your status, as opposed to cheap jump scares. For me, they were unnerving, but not annoying, although I can definitely see why some players would be pretty peeved by them.
Oh, fuck off, man!
Oh, I am peeved!
I'm willing to bet that Frictional will put out a patch to reduce the frequency and intensity of these flashes based on the player feedback since launch. Until then, light your matches, motherfuckers, you'll be fine. They're everywhere. Way more plentiful than the tinder boxes were in the first game, which is greatly appreciated. Makes less sense because you're in fucking alien land for 60% of the game, but who gives a shit? You gotta gamify the games. While we're on the topic of this game's environments, though, here's a hot take, maybe. I think the environments are actually the weakest element of this game, a crutch that it leans on for a majority of its runtime. The otherworldly levels become banal through exposure. You quickly realize that they're all just human places that are alienified. Laboratory, but alien. Surgical theater, but alien. Subway station, but alien. I'm sorry, but I don't go to Amnesia for subway station, but alien. So now that we're officially knee-deep in Spoiler Lake, let's go back to the beginning of the story and do a little setup. You start the game looking for your husband after a plane crash, and immediately my mind snapped right back to Outlast 2 and I started going,
Lynn!
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 But thank God you find that motherfucker's cold corpse in 45 minutes, he gives you a lantern, and that shit is over and done with. This game is not find your loved one that you as a player don't know but are supposed to care about. I was expecting a lot of Salim! Salim! And luckily we didn't get that, but as a substitute we did get both a boat and truckload of Mother Marys and little ones. At least she's not screeching dick balls fuck every 45 seconds. As you might have gathered by now, the woman you play as in Rebirth, Tassie Trianon, is a speaking protagonist. with a heavy emphasis on speaking.
No.
All the goddamn time. A talkative protagonist is another thing I specifically gave Outlast 2 shit for, and while this game does share some core mechanics and central faults with Red Barrel's unsuccessful sequel, everything that Rebirth does similarly to Outlast 2, it does much better than Outlast 2. Chases aren't beaten like a dead horse, the monster encounters feel more fair and more frightening, and Tassie Trianon is certainly a more engaging protagonist than Blake fucking Langerman. She's more level-headed, more relatable, less shouty, and brought to life by what I can confidently say is the most convincing and genuine performance ever in a frictional game. Daniel from The Dark Descent is a wonderful horror protagonist, your classic confused Brit locked in a monstrous manner, but he was a little two-dimensional, and the dude from Soma was just straight annoying in my opinion, so there's not a whole lot of competition with regard to protagonists in frictional games. But I actually really liked Tassie, despite the fact that I would have preferred she stay quiet a little bit more often than she does. Just shut up for like 15% more of the game. Please. While I obviously prefer non-speaking, or at least mostly silent protagonists in my horror games, helps you sink even deeper into the role in my opinion, I do think that Rebirth does the best job a horror game can with a constantly chatty lead character. 90% of the time, Tassie was saying pretty much exactly what I was thinking right when I was thinking it, even down to little frustrations like mumbling about a particular rock being heavy or some shit. There are so many lines recorded for so many different minor interactions, ranging from picking up specific props to staring at parts of the environment for an extended period of time, and that reactive voice acting really buffed up Tassie as a character and helped me connect with her point of view, enhancing her voice work through subtle game design, which is fantastic. Moving on from the character of Tassie, let's talk about what everybody's actually here for, and that is shit like this. Not feeling it. Amnesia Rebirth is scary as fuck when it wants to be. But the problem is that it doesn't want to be scary all that often. There are just enough frights scattered throughout the runtime to keep me interested, mostly appearing in the form of short chases, brief handcrafted spooks, or sneaking segments, but I wish they'd pushed harder on the horror here and innovated a bit more. Instead, we basically get Amnesia 1.5. Still a good game, but a little lost in its dated execution of first-person horror. If Rebirth dropped in 2013, people would have lost their goddamn minds, but in 2020, we're 5 years post-Alien Isolation, 7 years post Outlast, and this particular experience doesn't do enough to set itself apart and improve upon those experiences that already improved upon the Dark Descent's original formula in their own unique ways half a decade ago. Frictional clearly wanted to tell a powerful story more than they wanted to scare the living fuck out of people, and while I do think Rebirth holds a solid narrative in its big ol' belly, I don't think it's as compelling as they think it is. The story falls short of something truly memorable, and therefore the game as a whole suffers in a big way. The Dark Descent mainly focused on its scares, and for the time, its scares were top fucking tier, and that's why it stood out. That's why it's such a classic. It executed on its principal focus flawlessly, and Amnesia Rebirth's principal focus, instead of horror, is its narrative, and that narrative doesn't pack as big a punch as the Dark Descent spook factor did back in 2010. TLDR! The game isn't as scary as it should be. And the monsters. There's really only one monster for the majority of this game, and the monster is just Skinny Man. I've seen Skinny Man before. Skinny Man's been in a lot of things, and frankly, I'm getting tired of Skinny Man. Sure, Flappy Jaw Man was a walking punchline, but I'll take the creativity of Flappy Jaw Man over Skinny Man any day of the man. Despite the main creature's lackluster aesthetics though, the ghouls undeniably provide a nice handful of sphincter-tightening set pieces. The water chase in the first 4 hours was just a waking nightmare. The nest sequence was deeply disconcerting. The moment in the tank was the most effective use of claustrophobia I've ever encountered in this medium, and oh, that scene with Yasmin is my favorite scene this studio has ever put together. For real spoilers here, guys, don't watch this if you want to play this game. But I do want to talk about this scene for 1 second. Initially, this moment starts off terrifying and hopeless as a corrupted version of this once wonderful woman creeps out of the shadows. But then you see Yasmin trying to fight what's happening to her, and the monster ends up helping you. It's just a chilling and subversive scene from start to finish, and I think the game is worth it for that alone. Alright, so these hot takes videos are supposed to be relatively short, so I'm gonna cut myself off here and wrap it up with this. As a sequel to the landmark bombshell that was The Dark Descent, Rebirth falls short. But on its own merits, I think it's a pretty good game, and if you need a new title for spooky season, this is the one I'd recommend, especially for only 30 bucks. It sags in the middle and peaks in the first 4 hours at this badass fort level, but there are some wonderfully unnerving highlights and surprisingly effective emotional turns in the back half, all leading to a multiple choice ending with a variety of interesting outcomes. It's fun, give it a shot, and happy Halloween!